but there are many who haven't got a clue as to what this is all about. And I also recognize that they have no clue about how their emotions interact with society as well. And so it is important that we go to the roots to begin to understand the science of spiritualism. And I want you to know that we understand something that others, or I might say scientists, have called the field. And it's something that we all need to become familiar with. The negatives, the obstacles that are in our way, as well as those things that bring us the challenges that make us grow and understand who we are and why we're here. You know, it has been said many times and it has been proven that wisdom is powerful. And so it behooves each of us to seek for more wisdom as we live each day of our lives, as we go along on this earth plane. In the 19th and 20th century, science was a prominent part of spiritualism. As we go into the latter part of the 20th century and into the early part of the 21st century, we know that a lot of that which we do has been proven by spiritualists. And so they felt there was no need to go any further. And therefore, in my opinion, the science of spiritualism has fallen into the trenches of others. Other churches, other organizations are still doing investigations in spiritualism. Today, I feel we remain in the background. We remain a philosophy and a religion. And am I satisfied with that? No, I'm not. I feel it's important that we revive the science of spiritualism. You know, some 3 or 4 years ago in the National Convention, we passed a law we passed that we would revive the science of spiritualism, and the second Sunday in August was set aside as Science Day. Many still do not practice it. Many are still not aware of it. And so, you know, back in my days in the 70s and the 80s, I was involved with getting my feet wet in the science. I lived in Washington, in Virginia, right near Washington, and was involved with going to the Mind Research Foundation. It was founded by two gentlemen. The one is probably known to a lot of you because you're familiar with Belk Lindsay Storrs. And Belk was into the science of spiritualism. I also was had the opportunity, living in Virginia, to go to the laboratory of the late Dr. Robert Monroe, where all the studies are doing and continue today. And then I was fortunate enough to be directed to help someone, and it was through that direction I was sent to the Science and Philosophy of Humanity near Waynesboro, Virginia. And at that time, as fate would have it, my husband was transferred to Waynesboro, Virginia. Coincidence? I don't think so. So I got my feet wet. But you know, the more I look at our science and our philosophy, my heart breaks for the fact that we're not doing something with the science. And so Marilyn, whose feet are wet, has now jumped in whole hog, and my project is reviving the science. I've already taken steps and already have people interested in working on the science, which is from the cell root right through our mediumship. I want to share with you a book that our club is reading at the present moment. We started out looking into sciences, and this was one book that was selected. And so I have found, here's a book of science that justifies everything we do in spiritualist medium demonstrations. Science has actually proven it. It just hasn't been publicized because the only people interested are the parapsychologists and the psychic groups. So it's time that we take the banner and we lead spiritualism forward. The name of the book is The Field, The Quest for the Secret Force of the Universe. And it was written by Lynn McTaggart. Another small book that you may be interested in is written about Dr. Walter Russell, The Science and Philosophy of Man. Both of those are good foundations to start with. So I'd just like to mention that to you in case you're interested. You know, we've been told over and over again, the answers are all out there, all we have to do is tap in. Well, guess what? Scientists have proven it. So it's up to us to become knowledgeable. It's all there. We just have to get into the zone, more frequently called the field. Science has proven it's true. And if science can prove it's true, why don't we do something to establish little laboratory setting investigations so that we can say we have proven it true by this means, just not by demonstration of mediumship. This field we talk about is an expansive zone that stretches throughout the universe, and it's up to us to gain more interest and more understanding of it. Science tells us that there's a great reservoir of energy, and what many don't realize, everything is energy, from the human to the animal kingdom, to the chairs, to the pulpit. Everything is energy in different form. And so it's important for us to understand that, because when we make our transition, we continue in energy in a different form and a different mindset as we grow on the spirit side of life. Quantum mechanics has demonstrated there's no such thing as a vacuum. There's no such thing as nothingness. Everything is energy. So there is no void. We breathe and we live in a universe of a sea of energy, a sea of light, a sea of motion. And we all are a part of that sea. A matrix is a medium that connects two or more things. And this is something more that is being explored more and more each day. It's a region of big influence today. And so, like I said, I've jumped into the pond, and I don't intend to stop. So I'm getting my feet wet in a new direction of speaking and bringing spiritualism to the forefront as a science. You know, there's two common expressions we often hear, and they create emotions. One of them, and I know you've heard it 100 times, just as I have, when you're with someone, and they get a phone call, or if somebody says something to them, and they say, "Oh my God," in a tone of disdain and hurt and fear of what is going on, what is happening. And then you can be with someone again, and something, or a call, or an email, or something comes through, and they say, "Oh, how great that is!" And the joy and that vibration just permeates that person and you too, because you are together. One delineates fear, the other delineates joy and gaiety. Which would we rather have in our lives? The first, it fits under the natural law of fear, and that is, and I quote, "It prescribes that an unpleasant emotion causes an alarm or an anticipation of danger. It is negative and is destructive to one's consciousness," unquote. So if we know this, we know that when something is done consciously or unconsciously that is negative, we've set an action into having to face a reaction. And then the person says, "Oh my gosh, karma. I wonder if what I said last Monday brought this about. I wonder if what I did caused this." So it causes us to think. It brings us also to the law of understanding. And so when someone expresses, "Oh my God," don't let yourself sink into that vibration. Don't let yourself to let that tone affect you. try to keep yourself elevated spiritually so that you can combat those negative factors. Thought kicks in. Maybe it's my thought. Maybe it's all that thinking I did the other night. Maybe I better look at this. As soon as we allow ourselves to elevate our consciousness, we start lifting the elevation of a higher frequency, and all of that negativity sinks further to the bottom. As soon as we allow ourselves to recognize the natural laws, and there she goes again, well, as I told you before, you'll hear it all the time, because we're affected by the natural laws every day of our life, and if we know more about them, we can make our life a lot easier. Remember, we are our creators, and we have to accept our responsibility. You know, another thing that I thought about as I was sitting, mulling over these thoughts was a good example of negative and how it affects us. Just think, in the last year or so, we've been going through a political campaign. And then there was an outcome. Some were happy and some were not happy. It doesn't make any difference. But the term hate has surfaced. And it has surfaced that you hear it every day. In the grocery store, all over, every place you go, somebody is saying, I hate. I hate is dangerous. We need to recall another thing. All of our souls are connected to that one divine spirit. We are all one, whether we accept it or practice it or not. But that emotion of hate creates an imbalance in your system. If it continues, it brings on illnesses. And it brings on feelings of loneliness and feelings of disgust. It does nothing for us. So it's necessary that we who know better bounce back out of that vibration. And some say, I hope I can bounce back. Let me tell you, you don't have a choice. You will. But will you bounce back and remain on a higher frequency? Or will you be subjected to the negativity that's around us? Remember, every cause has a reaction. And each one, we have to face the reality of that reaction. So we want to create the best for all. As I said, there's an incalculable energy in the field. And in that field, we can draw that energy unto us. And that's another thing we need to learn. So you see, just from what I said so far, there's a lot that we can learn from science if we begin. And so this is my new beginning, and I hope it's yours. We know also that there are some people that say, the natural law really isn't anything, that's man-made. Well, isn't it odd that all the laws we make change over and over again? Congress changes laws, the president changes laws, everybody changes laws, bylaws and in-laws and outlaws. But the natural law hasn't changed. So isn't that different? We need to think about that. We need to realize that the external barriers that are around us are the things that we have to break through. Because only once we can understand that outside of us can we really understand the internal. And we need to go within so that we can touch into that field of energy and get the answers that we're all looking for. Get that substance which will keep us strong. We must consciously try to raise the frequency of our own being. And as we do that, we attune to the higher teachings that come from above. We don't have to sit and go in trance. We can get it just by sitting in the quiet and attuning to nature and let nature speak to us. If we do this, we will also realize there's another side of the coin, and that's the side that we call the happiness and the joy and the gaiety of life. Simply finding your mission can change your life. And I hear people say all the time, I don't know why I'm here. Well, it's time to find out. If you're thinking that today, you need to find out why you're here. You know, the way to simply start is by helping others. Don't we say our principle every Sunday, do unto others? Well, that's what we need to do. Because as we enhance and encourage others, we also enhance our own being. What you give out comes back tenfold or more. We know that. We've all experienced that, both positive and negative. So we want to remember that if we're capable of helping others, we should step out and let that be our first way of finding out who we are and why we're here. You know, if you're stressed out, and if you have a low vibration yourself, a low frequency, you cause a problem for those that you're trying to help. Why? Because your aura contains that which is within you. And if you're not thinking in an elevated consciousness, they feel that. And so if we want to help others, we have to continue to help ourselves by improving the inner being. We worry about looking in the mirror and getting all our makeup on and everything done just right. But it's more important for us to stand and look in that mirror at self and say, what can I do? What can I do? That's what we need to do. You know, our emotions are like a contagious disease. If we feel bad and we're grumbly and we're complaining, we're then putting out an energy field that's affecting everyone around us, and we cannot complete a mission as long as we throw out the negatives. Remember, to overcome any obstacle, you have to have determination. You have to have strength. You have to have courage. And you have to take whatever comes your way. We've heard it said before, it's not what happens, it's what you do with it. So expect the obstacles. Accept them as something that you can work through, something that you can grow from, be a better person. And you know, when you do that, it gives you a sense of value. And when you have a feeling of value, you feel good. You feel, I've done something right. I've done something that was helpful. I'm happy. I hope I can do some more. That human mind that we all have is so powerful. And that mind can help direct us into doing that which is right and that which is best for all. The mind, the brain, the soul, every part of us is connected by a network of communication. You know, for years, everybody thought everything was in the mind. And now they're recognizing the mind and soul is in every cell of the body. It was first discovered by Dr. Candace Pert about 12, 15 years ago, and they all said, the woman's nuts. Physicist, well known, but she's nuts. Guess what? They're now promoting the theory. They're now saying, gee, I wonder how she got that so soon. So sometimes the message comes slowly, but as long as it finally comes, that's what's important. Have you thought about yourself? Have you thought about the blood flowing through your veins? It knows exactly how to go away from the heart. It knows how to come back to the heart. The valves of the heart open and close. All the organs of the body, all the many organs of the body, all act, interact with each other. And you don't push a button to make it work. It just happens. A divine energy that brought this human body into what it is today. You know, somebody I was talking to the other day and saying something about this, and they contradicted me and they said, well, you're all wet, because how do you know that? How do you know everything is connected? I said, take every animal, right down to a snake. They all have a backbone. They all have organs within them. Your own pets, you take them to the vet, because the pancreas isn't working. You know, we all are interacted. Nothing is separate. We have a wiring. We have a path that carries everything throughout every part of our body into the deepest cell. So, the immaterial and the unseen right here on earth. I'm not even talking about out there, but right here on earth is so powerful that we need to know how it operates. We need to understand the intelligence and how it goes on. We as spirituals use the term infinite intelligence. Do we ever think about what it means? I've asked several people and they look at me and go, what? Why? Because we don't discuss the science of spiritualism. As we travel the pathway of our emotional field, we have to realize that it's up to us. It's a do-it-yourself project. You can make yourself, principle, isn't it seven? We make our own happiness or unhappiness. Why? Because we affect every cell in our body, one direction or the other. Whining, self-pity, repeating the same conditions over and over again only brings more negativity, and you reach nothing. You don't solve any situation. So we need to learn to change our way. A Buddhist teaching is, and I quote, adversity brings the ability to change poison into medicine. Isn't that a good lesson? Change the negative into the positive. Say it in whatever kind of words you want to use. It all means the same thing. So I want to quote to you something from Linda Taggart's book. And this is what she said. No matter how powerful the determination, no matter how well prepared we are for obstacles, expected or not, no matter how much personal responsibility we take, and no matter how good we may be accepting the pains of life, the unpleasant truth is that some maladies in life just can't be remedied, and some goals just can't be achieved. So instead of striving to knock your head against a stone wall, when it happens over and over again and you can't make the breakthrough, let go. That's what she says. Let go. Turn yourself looking towards another direction. Allow yourself to look for something else, something better. Perhaps it's that moment when you can give encouragement and bring that encouraging emotion to others. Maybe it's that moment that you can activate a positive thought in someone. You can help them raise their frequency. You can encourage others to ignite themselves, their emotional field. And you can encourage them that you should know that as you do this encouraging for them, it bounces right back to you. Don't we teach what goes out comes back? It happens. It happens with our emotions. It gives us an unfaltering power of the human spirit. And that's one reason also why spiritualism teaches meditation. It's not to sit around and get messages. You don't get messages in meditation. Meditation's definition is pondering a specific thought for a specific period of time. And so in that meditation, we also turn ourselves to the sensing of breathing properly. And as we breathe, we bring in energy. And as we breathe out, we let out the toxins within our system. And so meditation has an effect on raising your frequency. And that's why we say meditate. If you want to get messages, sit in the silence and listen to that still small voice, and it'll come. Mediums who demonstrate the best connection of communication are those who meditate. And you can tell a medium from another medium by their demonstration, because if they've meditated, if they've sat and pondered the spirit world surrounding them, the spirit world surrounding the church, bringing the energy of the spirit world together, they have done their job. It's a time that allows us to reach a higher frequency, to go in what I call my zone. And when you get there, you're into that field of energy, and you're picking up the vibrations. And you know, each person putting out a negative vibration is recorded in the energy field of the universe forever. You've heard people talk about Akashic Records. Well, I think that's what it is, because if everything everybody does is out there, it certainly is history and recorded. So as we go into this, we can become better and better people. We can become better because we try to elevate our consciousness so that we can help others. Spiritualism's philosophy does contain the natural laws, and if you go to part of them, they're spiritual laws, and if you go to the other part of them, they're the laws of nature that affect the scientists in the laboratories. They're the laws that tell us about the scientific aspect of the universe. You know, to sort of tie this together, our national manual has a section that says self-culture. And it gives us things, what we should cultivate, and those positive things which relieve us from all the heavy weight of negativity. It helps us in our consciousness. And as we go into that, it also tells us the things to avoid. So I just want to do a small experiment here. I want to speak these words, and I want to see how you feel emotionally. Fear, hate, gossip, suspicion, jealousy, clicks, worry. Did it make you feel good? I don't think so. Those are the negatives. Those are some of the things that are expressed, that are in our manual, that we can read about. But let's try it the other way around. How do you feel hearing this? Courage, silence, generosity, mercy, cooperation, tolerance, love. Don't you feel better? Makes a difference. It makes a difference. These five sensations that we all send out, you know, we have to start learning to control our emotions so that we don't send out negatives. And as I conclude, I'd like to ask you to try this coming week to change any negativity that faces you into something positive. That's a task we all can work on. Remember, emotion is defined as, I quote, a state of consciousness to do with the arousal of feelings distinguished from other mental states and cognition. It's simpler said, emotion is the part of a person's character that consists of their feelings. And as to their thoughts, that includes intuition. It includes that inner being. Yes, we have to deal with our emotions daily, and if we let fear and anger come in our way, we hurt ourselves as well as those around us. But we can bring joy into the world by thinking positively. Let us come into the realization of how important it is to have our tasks and take control of things and take control of our emotions. Remember, you need to associate with positive people, because if you have your group of people around you that are negative, it'll bring you down. It'll bring you down. You have to use all of your energy to raise your own frequency. So associate with positive people. And remember, more than anything, your actions speak louder than your words. Use your spiritual emotions properly and allow others to use theirs. And take all the lemons and make lemonade.